It is the main reason which leads to induction, to the belief in induction. The belief that knowledge, and especially scientific knowledge, starts from observation. That a widespread belief, which is, I think, still as widespread as it ever was. Only a few people understand that this is not so and cannot be so. All observation presuppose other knowledge. You cannot observe anything without knowing that certain things exist, that things should be so and so, because according to our knowledge, they are so and so, and this observation shows either that they are so and so or they are not so as expected. To make it quite clear how much observation does presuppose knowledge, we can, for example, refer to what is called auscultation. Auscultation is investigation of my inside with the ear or with a stethoscope, and which is done by doctors. And I would say if you now put your ear to my chest and try to find out anything, you will hear noises which mean nothing to you. Perhaps that you hear my heart beat, but that will be the nearest, and even this will be due to prior knowledge. So it will be prior knowledge of my, that I have a heart and that the heart beats, which leads to your identification or to your interpretation of what you have heard. And a doctor who does, for whom this observation of my heartbeat or of the noises in my chest means much more, it means much more because he knows already how to interpret it. Now, my thesis is all our observations are of this character. That is to say, a child has to learn how to see, how to hear. At first, the seeing, the eyes of a child give it information which means nothing to the child, just chaos. And only after having learned a lot, is the child capable to observe anything at all. So knowledge doesn't start from observation. We have to learn. But to learn is based, the capability of learning is based on inborn knowledge. We know of animals which have set inborn knowledge. They are born as clever as they are when they are dying. They know all things which they ever will know by heredity. And there are other animals which have a higher knowledge apparatus which can learn, and to those we belong. And they have inborn knowledge of how to learn. But it is again inborn knowledge, the knowledge of how to learn. Logically impossible to learn how to learn, how to learn, how to learn. There must be some inborn knowledge there, namely the knowledge somehow of the baby how to learn. Because then it learns and then it acquires more and more knowledge, among them the knowledge of how to observe and how to learn from observation. But another aspect which is here terribly important, and which shows how wrong people are who believe that all knowledge or all learning or all science starts from observation. And that is this. Observation is based on our sense organs. But our sense organs have clearly very limited biological function. Namely, their function is when we to help us when we have learned how to see and so on. The function is to give us information about the momentary state of our environment. Momentary state. Little momentary cuts from what the environment really is. But this presupposes that we already have a certain knowledge of the environment in a much wider sense, that we know that there is an environment, that we know, for example, if I sit here, I know that there's something behind me, which I don't observe now. In other words, we have to have actually very detailed knowledge of our environment if momentary information is to mean anything to us. The sight, for example, may inform an animal of the approach of an enemy, but for that it must already know something about enemies and friends and such things. So there is a lot of knowledge needed in order that momentary information is of any significance and meaning for us. And this is forgotten by people because the momentary information, it, what is striking us, what for the moment means most of for us, and therefore, the belief really that how do I know? By opening my eyes, by opening my ears, by looking, by listening. That's how I know. But that is a real mistake. This mistake is made by so many philosophers, for example, Carnap. In describing the problem of knowledge, says, how do you know? And then says, this is equivalent, how by what observation have you acquired your knowledge? So he really presupposes the idea that knowledge starts from observation. How do you know means for him, how have you acquired your knowledge by observation in several places. And he's quite a very considerable philosopher and very considerable man in the theory of knowledge. But this is really fundamentally wrong. It leads to induction. For if you think I obtain my knowledge by observation, then the next point is, yes, but how do I obtain my knowledge of general laws? Answer, by many observations. How else can you, if you obtain your knowledge of by observation, how can you acquire your knowledge of general laws, if not by many observations? And that is induction. So you are directly led to the theory of induction and to the belief in induction by the fundamental prejudice that you know by observation. That is, so to speak, the strength of induction or the weakness of induction. Strength, why people still believe in it, and weakness, why they still believe in it in spite of the fact that it's a mistaken theory. We learn very often by how quickly to eliminate, and thereby we to eliminate hypotheses. Actually, it's very important. Perception, a certain perception, is always a hypothesis. Also, what is called gestalt perception is a hypothesis. I perceive this is a book, but this is a hypothesis. It may be a piece of wood shaped like a book in order to deceive me or somebody else. Such things, of course, exist. It may be anything. But I have the hypothesis that it is a book, that is to say, the hypothesis is always an expectation. I have the hypothesis that when I take it and open it, there will be printed leaves. That is so. There are printed leaves. So I have expectations. All our perceptions involve expectations. Expectation is what gives real meaning in the biological sense, significance to our perceptions. The function of our perceptions is to form on the basis of this perception an expectation, that is to say, what will happen in the next moment. The momentary knowledge, the momentary information which our sense apparatus gives us, has the function to make us expect what will happen in the next moment, in the next minutes and so on, which is, of course, biologically very important. So we actually can see expectation and hypothesis are almost equivalent. Expectation is, so to speak, the biological equivalent to the more refined knowledge term, hypothesis or conjecture. This is practically equivalent. And our perceptions are a way of forming expectation of what will happen in the next second or in the next minute or in the next hour. That is not so important, it depends. So even our observations or our perceptions are real hypotheses. So hypothesis-free knowledge can't exist. And for that reason, the idea that knowledge starts with observation and leads perhaps to hypotheses or to law or anything like that is perverse, even though it is so widely spread and actually the basis of practically all theories of knowledge, except the theory of working with hypothesis and elimination, or as I call it in the title of my book, Conjectures, which is hypothesis and refutation of conjectures. This is the knowledge process, in my opinion, conjecture and refutation. Forming of hypothesis, of course, working with the hypothesis, and go on working with the hypothesis unless it breaks down, which is refutation. If there are uniformities, and that is what we search for, then there will be possibility of making predictions. And the possibility of making predictions is therefore a consequence of the task of science in looking for uniformities. So science must make predictions in order to find out whether there are uniformities or not, whether its hypotheses are true or not. Hypotheses of a kind of general character always will imply that we make predictions and test the hypothesis by a prediction. But prediction is not the same as induction. But many people think if we make predictions, we assume induction, which is quite wrong. We test whether uniformities are uniformities. We test whether our hypotheses are really giving uniformities. For this, we must make predictions. And that is that. It is, there is no element of induction involved. These people always think it is. And that, I think, is a mistake. Yes. Prediction does not mean induction. That is the issue. And I don't think anybody can say that my theory involves either proof or a proof which establishes certainty or high probability or near certainty or anything of that kind. I think nothing of that is really involved in my theory. If my theory is involved, prediction, but always prediction which may be falsified. So there is never really the question involved of inductive proof or inductive high probability.